Hi, everyone. Welcome and thank you for joining us. My name is Alon Reutman. I'm a business development analyst here at OurCrowd. We have people joining us from all over the world today. We have people from the US, people from Australia, from Spain, from Belgium, from Japan. So it is great to see all of you here together with us tonight, this morning, this evening. And we're going to have a great webinar for you today. We're going to speak about IoT, cybersecurity, and financial crime. As we all know, the distribution of sophisticated attack methods and the level of risks that organizations are facing has become much more of a bigger threat and ongoing trend that is happening in the last couple of years. So we have some of the best experts to join us today. You will be able to ask them any question you want at any point of the webinar. We also will have a dedicated time for a Q&A at the end, but if any question if you have any question coming up to your mind, just please send your question throughout the webinar. We will start by a quick overview of OurCrowd, and then we will continue with our macro view about innovation in times of crisis. And then we will continue with our perspective on the current situation of financial crime and by Aaron Chazan from ThetaRay. We will continue with presentations of Phil Naray from CyberX, Iran Fine from Nanolock, and Tion Arel from IXDen. After that, we will have the dedicated Q&A. So I would like to present our first speaker who will give the overview of OurCrowd, Lali David, the head of business development and partner here at OurCrowd. Lali, please.
Thank you, Alon. Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and thank you for joining us. Very quickly, overview of OurCrowd. So OurCrowd is the most active investor in Israel. We are a unique platform, a venture platform. We choose companies to invest in, and we invite the crowd to join us in those investments. The crowd is a diverse crowd of accredited investors, corporate VCs, family offices, institutional investors, and others. We already have more than $1.4 billion committed to different investment opportunities. We vetted more than 10,000 funding applications. We invested directly in more than 200 different portfolio companies and 22 different funds. This is a snapshot of our portfolio. This keeps updating literally weekly. You see it's very diverse across different sectors. We think it's very beneficial to be interdisciplinary and we see companies that are synergetic across different disciplines. This webinar focuses on cybersecurity. You can see the different funds that we've invested in. Some of the funds are funds that we have created, like Cure in Digital Health. We have funds that we are taking in the limited partnership position in for the benefit of our investors. In mobility, we invested in Maniv, in sport, in Advantage. We have early stage funds in Israel, like F2 and OFEC, both are leading VCs here in Israel, and funds outside of Israel, like USVP, Proof, Ox. The funds as well are very diverse. This is something we're very proud of. We have 4 licenses from the government of Israel for incubators that are backed by the government. The funds are either geographic or thematic or both. In cybersecurity, we have Labs 08 in Be'er Sheva. In digital health cybersecurity, we have Labs 02 for deep tech in Jerusalem. We have food tech in Kiryat Shmona and cannabis in Yerucham in Israel. And we also have 1 incubator outside of Israel in New Zealand. This gives us a very good visibility into early stage investment opportunities. When we invest alongside leading VCs, whether it's corporate VCs or financial VCs. We invest alongside leading angel investors on the same terms, in the same rounds, in the same companies. And we collaborate with different multinational companies. We have strategic agreements with different financial institutions, including UOB, UOB Reliance and NAB in Australia. And very recently, we signed a significant distribution and strategic agreement with Stifel from the US, an agreement that we are very proud of. We have OurCrowd Innovate, which is our innovation program. This enables us to collaborate very precisely and very effectively with different enterprises and to be their partner alongside their innovation journey. We have partners such as Halma, Changi, Hitachi, Toyota Tsusho, Bank Colombia. So this again is across sectors and across geographies. We basically go through understanding the pain points, the needs of the different enterprises alongside their innovation journey. And we divide the services and the assistance that we provide alongside blocks like knowledge, engagement, and community, our innovation blocks. I'm happy to introduce Dan Fischel, who leads OurCrowd Innovate and has done a lot of research into how innovation needs to be done specifically now in times of crisis. What are the opportunities? What are the challenges? And what are the needs today? Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Lali. So I'm going to condense a full hour of presentation into 5 minutes. And I think the most important thing to realize that we're talking about a crisis that is medical in nature. However, its implication on our economy is mostly psychological. So I'm not an expert in psychology, but I think most of you would agree that the world is somewhere now between depression and acceptance. However, there is another psychological term that is very, you know, common. It's called the mirror exposure effect, that it basically means that we all tend to focus on what's familiar. And because corporations are run by humans, the corporations also tend to focus on what's familiar, which basically means their core business. So corporations basically focus on what's safe and predictable at this time. And they basically cut back on everything that is not core business. We've seen it in previous crises, we're seeing it right now. There's only one problem with the strategy. If you just focus on what's safe and predictable, you're gonna end up in the, you know, corporate graveyard with the tons of other companies that did not realize or were focused on what's safe and predictable for way too long after the economy has changed. Now, this is based on hard data. Credit Suisse has found out that the average life expectancy of a company on the S&P 500 index is going down exponentially. Now, this is happening, at least in recent years, because of tech disruption. And tech disruption, as we all know, it's not new. It's been with us since the Industrial Revolution when cars were disrupting horses. But what's unique to this time in history is that it happens much faster than ever before. And that's because tech adoption happens much faster than ever before. You can see here on this chart that it took Americans 50 years to adopt electricity in their homes. It took only 10 to adopt a smartphone. Now, this was before COVID. What's happening now is a tech acceleration in a rate never before seen in human history. And there are many indicators. If it's Amazon that's hiring 100,000 people, if it's Ocado, which is like the largest UK supermarket, online UK supermarket that has introduced virtual queues. You had to go and wait for 2 hours just to be let into the website to do your grocery shopping. Now, you might claim that for every company that got quite lucky during COVID, there's others who don't, like Airbnb or Uber, and that's true. However, there's a few significant changes compared to all other times in history. And these are basically two or even three. The first is the tech adoption is reaching new demographics, like the elderly. Never happened before. It's changing consumer behaviors. I'd say more, it's changing human behaviors like never before. And if you're a corporation, it fuels a shift towards the cloud because, you know, the on-prem service, the on-prem IT infrastructure is not designed to support remote work. So here's a quick recap of what's happened just in the last few weeks. So in the UK Parliament, for the first time in 700 years, you can, if you're an MP, you can vote online. In New York, you can get married via Zoom, officially getting married. In Israel, you can file a complaint in the police online without having, you know, the burden to come to the station. We're all working from home, right? And it's working quite well. It's working so well to the extent that the Morgan Stanley CEO says, we don't need all this real estate. And the CEO of Barclays basically says the same. Crowded offices, thing of the past. Telemedicine. Who could imagine like a few years ago that, you know, you can just pick up your phone and speak with the doctor, the extent that now post-COVID or during COVID, over 50% of Americans either tried it or are willing to try. And those who try, the vast majority are saying, I'm gonna continue using this service. And of course, we're all talking about online grocery shopping. It's been all over the news, we all know about it. Sales nearly tripled. And 39% are first-time elderly people, elderly customers. So when we're looking at all these like amazing changes, like in a spike of tech adoption that is happening right now, guys, it's not going back. Tech adoption is a steady trend, or it's like it's a one-line trend. Even after COVID, you will be able to get married via Zoom. You will be able to file a complaint online with the police. And if we were basically to put this on as a qualitative on this graph, it's just like a straight line right now, 2020, the year on when basically everything that hasn't been digital is being digitized. So we have to bear that in mind because technology has changed our economy and it happened much faster than any time in history. Now, another trend that is worth thinking about is automation. And by automation, I mean is the, basically the trend where machines are replacing humans. And we tend to think about it intuitively as something that happens gradually over time. Every year, more machines replace more humans. And that's wrong. That's wrong. Automation happens in spikes, in bursts, and they're based and basically are centered around economic crisis. This is solid research done by universities. And so you can see that in the previous three recessions, because the relative cost of labor has gone up when company revenue go down, what they're doing is basically laying off people and replacing them with machines and highly skilled workers. It's happened for the last time in 2008. You can see a spike in the HR requirements for education, for experience, and for computer skills. Now, there is a research institute in DC, it's called Brookings, it's quite well known. They mapped 73 million jobs and they looked at their automation potential. By the way, PwC did the exact same thing, reached very similar numbers, double digit. So the automation potential across the US, it's 46%. And you can see that it's the highest around accommodation and food services. So it's basically, you know, the hotels and the restaurant workers that have lost their jobs. But there is something very different this time that was not, you know, in previous recessions. It's not just the number of people who lost their job, which is more than double the 2008 recession. This time we have AI. So AI was pretty much nascent in, at least in the current form in 2008, was non-existent in 2000. And in 1991, it was basically science fiction. Another thing that is worth mentioning here is where you have more automation, and there will be much more automation coming up, there is a much higher need of cybersecurity. Now, this was just a taster of the webinar we're gonna hold next week. We're gonna talk about several industry, healthcare, financial services, retail, travel, and supply chain. We're gonna look which one is gonna undergo an acceleration versus transformation, which industries will basically need a complete overhaul of technologies. We're gonna talk about who are the real competitors post-COVID. And I'm gonna give you a spoiler, it's startups. And we're gonna talk about what corporations should do at these times. And another spoiler, they should partner or invest in startups. And lastly, we're gonna talk about why the only vaccine to COVID post this pandemic is technology. So again, next week, Wednesday, 7:30 p.m. Israel time. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, Dan. That was fascinating. And I think that it really prepared us for our two topics for today, which are financial crime and IoT cybersecurity. As Dan was saying, we're gonna see this accelerated automation, accelerated transition to the cloud. So wherever your organization is, I think that any of the companies that are presenting today have something, a great value proposition for you. So I would like to move it on to our first speaker among our portfolio companies today, who is Yaron Chazan. Yaron Chazan is the financial crimes solution subject matter expert at ThetaRay. And he's gonna tell you all about ThetaRay and what they have found that is happening in the last couple of weeks since the outbreak of COVID. Yaron, please.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much. So ThetaRay is an intuitive artificial intelligence company that provides solutions to large corporations that solve challenges under crimes, whether they are cyber attacks, fraud, or anti-money laundering. And as we heard now, the use of artificial intelligence already started growing in the past few years, and we have seen it in the cooperation we have with our customers, and we also expect it to rise significantly soon. My role at the company is financial crimes solution subject matter expert. I know it's not a very common role in technology companies, But due to the uniqueness of the solutions of ThetaRay, we found that it's very important to make sure we understand the needs exactly for our customers. I have vast experience in the Israeli police, PwC as forensics and AML leader, HSBC Bank, etc. So to our case, cyber attacks, as we've seen them rising right now, by the way, a few weeks ago, the UK police, the French police, and also the Israeli police published that most of the criminal activities during lockout went down compared to previous years, and financial crimes went up. And especially cyber attacks and financial crimes through digital channels went up. And this is very, very easy to understand. Who are the attackers? The attackers could be fraudsters, those who want to steal our identity, to cover our accounts, and to make use of assets, mainly financial assets, but not only financial. It could be terrorists that want to disrupt the activity of society or to fund their activity from Israel on several websites and internet hosters. And it could be hackers in order to prove themselves that they can and to penetrate and impact specific. The sophistication is also getting smarter. In the past, if attackers found a channel and a way in, and they found a gate to enter a certain environment, they used it until it was blocked. Today, they keep changing their methods all the time. And this is why it is became so sophisticated to try and find them and detect them by doing what organizations felt that is safe, simple for them, and a known arena, like we saw in the presentation that happens during a crisis time. So cyber attacks during this era is also because there are many new users of technology that access their banking system or access services through the internet, and they have never done it before. Mature people or new people that never tried technology. Now they are more exposed because they don't know the risk well enough. At the same time, banks let their people connect from home. So if in the past, it's one of the most risky areas, the financial industry, and most vulnerable area to cyber attacks. And everybody working in a safe environment inside the office of the bank, now they should work from home. So the channels or the gates for the attackers became larger and wider. Cyber attacks specifically on ATMs were always attract bad guys. And today, when there are less people on the street, an ATM and take the money, as a hacker or as a thief, probably there will be less people around you. Because less people are on the street, less people are withdrawing cash. So at the time that people in the bank will see that something was stolen will be much in the later period. Cash for them is always the king. If they want to enter the financial system itself, the bank core systems, it's sometimes a bit harder, but the gate through the ATM as the extorse or the external gate, it's much easier. And especially if you try to attack the host between the ATMs and the bank system. And then all they need is to attack the connection units or to use fake cards. There are additional new schemes, such as worried banker that calls people that are usually don't use their internet and started using their internet connection to the bank account. Somebody calls them and asks them about them, and usually they will provide it. And even breaking into the core systems, as I said, because more people work remotely, became a bit easier. Now, if there are schemes and risks are changing all the time, can we use the same solutions and expect them to work? Of course, there is no. Bad guys are always one step ahead. In ThetaRay, it's the first time in my career that I feel that I'm one step ahead of the bad guys. And we saw example that people connect with their doctors remotely, now more frequently. But imagine that you ask a doctor to prescribe your medicine without even knowing who you are, without even knowing your medical background, without knowing anything about you. And this is the same way that we usually try to fight back those financial crimes, because we try to use things that we know and we believe that are good to any kind of attack, and we don't understand that attacks are changing every day. And what was good enough to protect us yesterday is not good enough today. I would like to introduce you to my son, a professional basketball player. And you can see in two pictures, in one picture, he's trying to shoot the basket with his eyes open. And when he holds the ball in two hands, and the other one, he's blindfolded and using only one hand. Now you can imagine what will happen when he's shooting the basket when he's blindfolded and one hand. He's so professional that he almost succeeded even that way. With his eyes open and holding the ball in two hands, naturally more. I think that with ThetaRay, we enable our customers to use all the information that they have, all the information that they own, in this example, using both hands, and with their eyes open, to identify something has changed, if there is new risk, if there is a new scheme of cyber attack. And this is how we help them find the needle in the haystack when it comes to financial crime. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Yaron. That was fascinating and great. And I think it really emphasized the point of how these ATMs, these devices can be the weakest link of your, the weakest link of your organization. This is what is this webinar is all about. It's the cybersecurity solutions that can protect your IoT devices. And another company that is doing amazing work on this front is CyberX. So I'd like to move it forward to Phil Naray, VP, Vice President of IoT and Industrial Cybersecurity at CyberX. Phil is gonna tell us all about the great work they're doing at CyberX. So Phil, please. Phil, if you will unmute yourself, we will also hear about the great work.
Thank you, Aaron. Okay, thank you and welcome. And thank you for inviting me to present today. Today I'm going to talk about managing IoT cybersecurity risk. There are various terms for this category. When we talk about IoT, we're talking about enterprise IoT, not the smart coffee makers you might have in your home. And some people also call it OT, which stands for operational technology, which is the sensors and various automation devices that you will find in factories and energy facilities, oil and gas, etc. So the devices that we find in these environments are particularly vulnerable for a number of reasons. One, unlike the desktops and servers that you have in your data center or in your corporation, you can't put agents on these. So there's no McAfee, there's no Symantec, there's no CrowdStrike, whatever it is. You can't put agents on them, and as a result, they're typically invisible to the IT team. The IT team doesn't know what devices are connected to their network or how they're communicating and have no idea, in fact, if they've ever been compromised. They weren't designed with security in mind. They're typically designed more about cost and functionality. They often have credentials that are either weak or have never been changed. They use a variety of open source. You can think of a camera that's built in China using open source web servers with tons of vulnerabilities. They're particularly attractive to cyber adversaries because they're often connected directly to the internet. So compromising these devices gives you direct access to the corporate network or the OT network and bypasses all of the other controls that you might have in place like firewalls. And the number of these devices is increasing very rapidly such that there are now three times more of these IoT or unmanaged IoT devices than managed devices that you have to protect in your corporation. And on the right, you'll see some examples of what I mean. Could be everything from building management systems at the top left, robotic warehouse systems at the top right, cameras we mentioned, building access controls at the bottom left, or devices in the factories themselves that are managing the production process. So the risk really can be exemplified by a couple of examples I'm going to talk to you about. You've all heard about ransomware shutting down factories. We saw last year that the Norsk Hydro facility that builds aluminum, that manufactures aluminum in Scandinavia was shut down, losing $70 million. But we've also seen the DHS in the United States showed that a container port was infected with malware, causing downtime. And of course, the biggest incident of all, NotPetya shutting down production at factories around the world, around food and beverage, pharmaceuticals, logistics like Maersk and various other industries. Another example would be the safety impact of a compromise in an industrial plant. We saw the Triton cyber attack a few years ago on a petrochemical plant. It was compromised with malware that had been specifically developed to compromise the safety controllers. In other words, the controllers that are in place to shut down the plant if unsafe conditions are reached. So this is a very, this raised the awareness that we're not just talking about production downtime, we're also talking about threats to human life and to assets. Two other examples, more on the IoT side than the industrial side. We saw a campaign that Cisco announced called the VPN filter malware, where adversaries were compromising VPN routers, which are exposed to the internet on one side and to your corporate network on the other side, using vulnerabilities to install their own man in the middle, MITM attacks and packet sniffing attacks, where they could sniff the traffic and inject themselves into the traffic to potentially infect standard endpoints like desktops and servers. And then the fourth example is a attack that Microsoft discovered last August, where adversaries used vulnerable voice over IP phone as well as printers and other devices to compromise the device, and then from there pivot into the corporate network looking for sensitive intellectual property. So these are all four examples of where IoT attacks or OT attacks lead to business risk. And then if you look at the Verizon data breach investigations report that was released just yesterday, they showed that sensitive intellectual property is a top risk for manufacturers, the theft of it. They found that more than one out of four breaches in manufacturing are motivated by cyber espionage, that nearly four out of 10 attacks are driven from nation states. And we're talking here about theft of formulas. So if you're a pharmaceutical company, your formulas are someone's going to try to steal them. We just saw in the last few weeks, in fact, that there was various campaigns around stealing COVID-19 related research. But it could be you're designing a new automotive part. You've spent years designing it to make it as aerodynamic as possible, and then someone steals it. It could also be manufacturing processes that you might have that are proprietary. So this is in addition to ransomware leading to downtime, in addition to safety environmental incidents, this is yet another risk, which is theft of sensitive intellectual property. And Gartner's recently written some reports. They call this category cyber physical systems. Number one, they're saying most enterprises are not even aware of what they have. So this is one problem that CyberX helps address, which is identify the devices and how they're communicating and whether they're patched or not patched. They go step forward and say, similar to what happened with Sarbanes-Oxley about 10 years ago, governments will hold C-suite leaders personally liable if they don't focus on creating more controls around safety and security. And then finally, that all of these functions really make sense in a single organization, which is typically the CISOs organization. So even though we're talking about security in a factory, it's just as relevant to the CISO organization as protecting the databases in their data centers. So how has COVID changed what's going on here? Well, number one, we all know more employees and third-party contractors are working remotely. When I say third-party contractors, I mean firms that have been hired to manage and maintain the equipment in your factory. It's often performed by either the company that sold you the equipment or a systems integrator that put it all together. And that's resulting in more traffic to networks through something called remote desktop protocol, which is a Windows remote access protocol, but there are others like VNC and others that are being used. And as a result, the adversaries are now looking to compromised networks using RDP as the attack vector and using weaker stolen credentials, using brute force attacks, or credentials that they've purchased on dark web forums to get into your network. And they're hoping to blend into a sea of legitimate traffic because there's now a lot more traffic. And so the chances are that they can pretend to be legitimate traffic getting into your network using RDP. And if you look at this graph, it says that RDP is actually the number one attack vector for ransomware. It's higher than phishing, higher than using zero days or other vulnerabilities. It's actually a very popular way to get in because once you're in, you can pivot into the network and look for other sources of sensitive data. You can elevate your privileges and move to the crown jewels of the organization, you having used RDP as the way in. And then if you look at this graph, it says that the number of RDP attacks have increased dramatically. That inflection point there that you see in the middle corresponds roughly to the first week of March. And it's broken down by country, but you can see that the US rate of RDP attacks is fairly high. So how are we helping our clients address these risks using our agentless platform? It's a network security monitoring platform that has zero impact on the network, and it monitors all of the packets on the network. So packets don't lie. Once you're monitoring the packets, you know exactly what's going on. And it also does not require any agents to be installed on the endpoints. So number one, continuous monitoring. CyberX has developed patented behavioral analytics. It looks at the behavior, doesn't look at signatures or known IOCs that change all the time. And the behavioral analytics have been developed to specifically focus on the unique characteristics of IoT and OT devices. So that delivers alerts faster with a faster learning period and with fewer false positives. And number two, we have an in-house threat intelligence team formed by former nation state defenders. The team is called Section 52, and they're continuously monitoring both open and closed sources for new IoT campaigns, and then updating our platform as a result. They've also developed some very interesting tools using machine learning to identify campaigns. And then finally, we've been asked by several of our clients to accelerate the deployment schedule for deploying the platform at additional sites. So when the COVID-19 pandemic started, they realized that there were sites that had not yet deployed our platform that were based on a planned schedule. And they said, hey, can you come in now and deploy these? And also, can you deploy them remotely without actually getting into the plant? And of course, we've complied with those requests to give them accelerated deployments and protection in these unique times. Here's my email address. I'll be open to any questions, and thank you for your time today. Back to Alon.
Thank you very much, Phil. That was great. And if you mind that I tell a fun fact about you, how clients of CyberX can also feel safer with CyberX. So for those of you who don't know, Phil actually has a black belt in jiu-jitsu. That's right. Am I correct?
Thank you, Alon. Yes.
Yeah, so that's another aspect of it.
I've also trained in Krav Maga, which is actually quite a unique martial art too.
So you have the whole packet. You have the you have the intelligence alumni, and you have, you know, the on-hand experience. So with this, I would like to forward it to Iran Fine, the CEO of Nanolock. Nanolock is an operating system agnostic flash to cloud protection solution for IoT edge devices. And I think this strongly relates to what we spoke about and the different presentations here, and that's the accelerated transition into cloud that different organizations are experiencing during these times. So, Iran, please.
All right. Good morning, afternoon, evening, and night, and early morning to everyone. I did see in the participant list a few friends and partners from around the world, so great to see you here. A few words about Nanolock. We're established in 2017. We have offices in Israel, Japan, and the US, and we have customers both in the US, Europe, Netherlands, France, another country who speaks Spanish in Europe. We have a very strong portfolio, and we've been recognized for our innovation in the last, almost since inception, Last year, we won Company of the Year in Barcelona 2019, and so on and so forth. So what we do and the innovative approach we have taken was recognized throughout the world. Basically, the major target or the major vertical that we're working in is infrastructure with a very powerful or very meaningful focus on smart meters, data concentrators, industrial electricity, water, and so on and so forth. These markets are under attack, whether for cyber reasons or state level attacks, but also for fraudulent and theft throughout the years, starting with attacks that occurred in Malta, Puerto Rico, but it got closer to Europe, and of course, numerous attacks in the US. The last few weeks have been very interesting because there were also attacks on the infrastructure in Israel, retaliation by Israel against Iran, and so on and so forth. The attacks here didn't happen or did not take place on the smart meters. They were in the industrial control system, the RTUs, and the infrastructure. However, they act very similarly. And what is common to many of the attacks, I think, was carried out by a combination of outsiders, classic hackers, insiders, technicians, or unhappy employees with credentials, or supply chain actors. There are numerous examples for each and every one of these. Insiders, there were attacks on starting from Facebook to Tesla and others, where you have either a unhappy employee or a converted employee or technician or supply chain manufacturer or partner, where he's either motivated by financial reasons, personal issues, to use his credentials to become an adversary. Supply chain, or in other words, the Chinese threat, poses an issue where you have critical components manufactured offshore, and it was announced that many of the manufacturing is going inshore. We are working with some customers who said, our business is happening, the manufacturing is happening outside of our country. We want to make sure that, number one, nobody's putting any malware or Trojan horse inside. And if it does, please prevent it for us and inform us about such a thing. So you have the classic hackers, the insiders, and the supply chain. And if you're trying to think, you have to get protected from all of them. The twist about COVID is that, in other words, COVID created chaos. And chaos is the patent bed for a lot of the attacks. And we see a lot of rises on attacks and manipulation, both for fraudulent reasons, but also for state level, because, yes, people are at home, devices and infrastructure is less taken care of, but also it's a chaotic environment, and that will continue. And through chaos, hackers thrive. The connected infrastructure that we're living in causes all of those threats, from the cameras, the campuses, the smart manufacturing, smart water utilities, smart energy utilities. Once you have data in, because the world is becoming connected, you have data out. Once you have data in, the data can be, or the code in, could be legit and fine, but could be manipulative. And slightly different from the previous speakers, we assume that the device itself will and is the attack vector. So we're not trying to protect the network, although it's a very important thing, and CyberX are doing phenomenal work in that. We're not trying to protect the organization from the device necessarily. We're trying to protect against manipulation of the devices, because in many cases, one can find that if this is done by an insider or supply chain, it goes well way beyond or below the threshold that an anomaly detection or other means will detect. So if things are done in a sophisticated way, in a smart way, and in many cases in a simple way, many of the current solutions will not capture or will be challenged with that. And this is why the approach, in many cases, we're seeing companies taking the network approach and asking us to come, because the attack vectors are now both from the network, but also from the device, from people that they simply cannot prevent or control their behavior. The infrastructure is becoming more and more vulnerable, with a lot of motivation for people to harm the infrastructure. Nanolock have come with a powerful protection and a quick recovery methodology where we prevent on a device level. We have a technology that we'll speak about in a second, but we prevent fraud on those devices, meaning somebody manipulating with the way the devices work. And if you have, for example, a meter that reads a number and an insider manipulates that and changes the number, you have a very smart, sophisticated fraud that can be used. This is definitely what happened in Puerto Rico. This is happening quite often in Brazil and in South America. So you have fraud, you have local damage and state level attacks. We protect from software bugs, but even unfamiliar vulnerabilities. It's very good to fight the war that just ended, but hackers are definitely getting smarter. They are learning breeds, and you have quite a lot of attacks that were never discovered or will be evolving and so on and so forth. So you need to be protected against also unfamiliar vulnerabilities, but also from software bugs, because apparently we're not perfect in the way we write the code and write all the protections, so there are always holes. We secure and validate and manage over-the-air updates. This is a new methodology. Instead of sending somebody with a USB or a disk to the field, you send updates over the air. When you have billions and billions of devices, over-the-air is becoming more and more common. And again, you're sending something in the air, in the clear, you have to protect it. We provide real-time status alerts and forensic data. So it's not that we're only defending and preventing the attack, we're informing the owner of the devices that we've prevented the attack, the nature of the attacks, and what was the attacker trying, the adversary trying to do through our device level forensic data. And the lastly, the way that we protect enables the customer a quick recovery, the classic restart. So we prevent any catastrophic change or any catastrophic, which is irreversible to the device. So in even the in the catastrophic event that somebody has been able to put a code, we make sure that the restart will take everything away. We, as I said, provide both the protection and the visibility to the edge devices, the alerts, and so on and so forth. We have customers that vary from the end industrial company itself or the utility. We have utilities that we work with, of course, in Israel, but also in Europe, Asia, with a very strong focus on Spain, on Japan, and in the US, we just signed up a new utility, but also we work with large service providers. I cannot share all the names. One of them is KPN in the Netherlands. Another one is a telco, large telco in Japan, a large telco in Singapore. So these are large service providers who are providing this wealth of data, wealth of services to their customers. COVID created a scenario or a demand for those devices, for those service providers to enhance their businesses and provide those feature sets of protecting the assets in a much more critical manner. We've brought to the market a clear value that starts with savings. We're reducing manufacturing and support costs by making sure that devices does not require a standing an engineer to repair them. We prevent theft, which is a direct saving. The average cost of breaching a smart meter is about, I think, $40,000 for the first 5 years of the device, including sending a technician. We eliminate the hacking and the patch cycle. On the safety side, we provide the power grid protection. We block the state level attacks and we prevent malicious takeovers and service interruptions, which are critical both in terms of saving, but also from safety perspective. And we're providing visibility and enforce the install base through the over the air reliable real-time detection, and the unique forensic data implies the fact that we provide our customers full control over their devices. One of the interesting case studies is from recent weeks is from a European power grid, which asks us both to protect his new devices as well as his legacy devices. The attack vectors started varied from a state-level attacks, but also what they call an organized crime going and manipulating the device. And the case study indicated that we're providing all of the values that we spoke about before. And I'm bringing this because the utilities are becoming a dramatic attack vector. It happened in Israel, it happened in Ukraine. because this is a perfect example of where we, you can have both a state-level attack on one side as well as a fraud or fraudulent attack on the other side. You have a very long supply chain. You have a variety of employees with different credentials. So although this is very critical, it generates or opens up a wealth of attack vectors to adversaries. Lastly, we introduced a very interesting approach into the market. Although we are protecting the devices, which usually use an OPEX, CAPEX approach, where you buy the device, you buy an expert protection, the value that we had brought to the end customer, the utilities, had brought us to offer an OPEX kind of an approach where you pay for the feature set and the services and the features rather than for the deployment of the inside the device or the cost of the device itself. And that had brought us and our customers an ability to, for us, a good way to monetize, but also the utilities were struggling with huge investments to be able to more leisurely or more relaxedly deploy both the cyber protection that we're offering. And we still see, and I'm relating that or connecting that also to the COVID, where the financial crisis requires different thinking. So utilities that never thought of this kind of an approach of connecting with a technology startup for a few years and thinking in an OPEX model are now open for that. And we see that as a dramatic change in the last few months. With that, I would like to thank you for taking the time and listen to me. And I'll be sharing my email and contact information through the chat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eran. And I think once again, we are understanding throughout this webinar how the edge devices might be the weakest link of your organization and what kind of measurements you should take in order to protect them. I would like to encourage you all to continue asking us questions. You're sending some great questions. And please take advantage of the fact that we have such great experts here with us in this call. We will, of course, also have a dedicated Q&A session at the end. I would like to present our next speaker, who is Tzion Arel, the CEO of IXDen. Just another note about IXDen. IXDen actually is a company that was funded by the OurCrowd Incubator Labs O2 that Lali presented in the beginning of this webinar. So this is just to give you a taste of the different methods we in OurCrowd adopted to enhance innovation at different stages. So without further ado, I'd like to move it forward to Tzion Arel, CEO of IXDen.
Thank you, Alon. Pleasure to be here. Hi, everyone. My name is Tzion Arel, and I'm the CEO of IXDen. We'll present today our new approach or different approach of looking at the IoT device and how to defend them. Few words about the company. We're established in 2017 in Tel Aviv, and we have an office in Houston. Our technology is looking at the normal behavior or abnormal behavior of devices. And when we talk about IoT devices, we're talking about sensor, gateway, PLC controllers, all the way to the ICS. Our customer coming from the critical infrastructure, we're working with water, oil, gas, electricity, and energy, both in the US, Europe, and Israel. And we are currently in the A round, and we actually closed today our first investors in the A round, so we are happy these days came. Here is my partner, Dr. Leonid Pupperman and Uri London. All of us came with the background in security, cyber, software. Coming to the point, I think people mentioned it before, but we're looking at the digitalization and we're looking at how sensors and IoT can improve themselves. We see more and more companies going to the edge and computing more smart devices. Also, we see more intelligent system analytics. Everything gets much better, including the protocols. So the companies are using much more devices, and I mentioned that you know it came all from sensor going to the PLC. But out of all of this, we're still seeing, and we're talking with companies, that about 80% of the sensor data are not transmitted through SCADA, which means that the OT people cannot really trust or see on the app what's happening down. So we are focusing our solution on trust. how can we trust the data? Because we feel that by using a lot of those sensors, trust is being not taken care correctly. Especially when we talk about devices which are weak, both on the operation, both on the physics and the cost. When we talk about the COVID-19, we see even from the point of view of the IT, we see much more risk came up. And again, the people before me already talked about us, and we did see some attacks coming up during the last weeks, both in Israel and mentioned it also in different critical infrastructure, but others as well. So IT faced a lot of problems, you know, with the COVID, but we also saw some problem came to the OT, which means, you know, that because the companies moved mostly to work in remote, they needed to manage their asset in remote, couldn't send technician to the field, didn't know what's happening actually in the field, still need to take decision and operate, you know, critical infrastructure. And especially when you talk about not even intention, which is cyber attack, which is and tampering, but also unintention, which is calibration, sensor malfunctioning, and those type of issues that can be happening every day. So COVID-19 actually showed us how technology is really important, but also the big problem of companies, how can we trust the device data? So IXDen came with out of the box thinking of this solution, which actually what we are doing, we actually looking at the behavioral of the sensors. We actually, and we call it data at trust, at the source, which means that we would like to see how can we trust the data that's coming from the sensor itself before it goes to the network of the organization. So to the TCP IP, this is where we live. What the company is actually came up with, it's a patented technology, which one grade, we call it IXDen, IXDen, which actually provide the organization the healthiness of the sensor data in one side, but also the security level from the other side. So we actually provide two solutions in one system, both for the IT and for the OT. And we're using a lot of course, machine learning and AI to do that. But the idea is actually to look at the abnormality of the behavior and bringing it to the OT people and the IT people in one grade. 255, meaning this is just an example of a quality of the data. The way that we do it, just in few words, we have an agent living south to the TCP IP, actually on the gateway level, which collects us information from the sensors, from the network, and from the hardware and software. And then we build what we call biometric identity. For any device, we build a biometric identity, which means that we are able to look at the device the same way that we're looking at the face of a person. And this is the difference here in the solution, because it gives us the ability to build an ID which is dynamic, which is changed, because a lot of those sensors that are changing. On the other side, on the server side, which live on the on-prem organization, we are doing multi-factor authentication, which actually for any transaction, we are doing set of questions, security questions, based on the proprietary mathematics model that we build, which enable us actually to provide a solution based on multi-factor authentication, which means a lot of security issue. And if you are analog into the financial, when you take money from cash machine, you've been asked one or two security questions. We usually ask between 20, 30, or even 40 different security the device. So the device is giving us the indication of the data. So this is the way that we do it. We are a software company. We are not dealing anything with the hardware. It's all about software. As I mentioned, we are working with different type of critical infrastructure company. In the electric side, we're working in project which is including smart grid and smart meters, which coming up today is a big issue for energy company. In waters, we're looking at threat management, desalination sites, pooling this site and all the operation around it. Oil and gas focus on upstream and midstream in the US, basically monitoring the all the operation around that. On the right side of this slide, you can see how the system is actually generating both data on behavior. This is representation on a graphic mode, but actually we can see that we can provide both penetration points, which is coming up from the system, as well as the abnormality or normality of behavior of sensor. And this is the way that we are presenting it to the organization. And they are able actually to take reaction. So we are doing the detection here for this system. So actually the big value that we provide to customer is the as I mentioned, is the trust, the ability to trust. We believe that the only way that we are actually provide trust is being able to collect information using an agent leaving southbound to the TCP IP. That's the only way to be able to make sure that the data that is coming from the sensor getting into the network are real and not fake. There is no other way to do it. That's our belief. So this is how the way that we do it. So then we're enabling a remote sensor detection, remote asset management organization from those type of attacks. The implementation of our system is relatively low due to the fact that we're not dealing with the hardware and the scale is just about the software. And the cost, of course, that we believe that this is the last slide is just the way that we feel that how can CISO and CIO should be prepared for the next wave of COVID-19. Hopefully it will not happen, but if it will happen, we believe that companies should be focusing on looking at how to take the technology to the next level, especially in the IoT and the devices, and trying to look from the OT, not only the IT, on issues that coming from the operation, not specifically from a cyber attack. Remote asset management, that's the name of the game. I know in the US, it's the big, right now, the big wave, how to make companies working in remote, how to monitor the data correctly, and how to detect and react. And also continue to accelerate the legacy system to IoT platform. I know it's that this is not an easy task, but that's, I think, the future. Everybody understand that. And last but not least, and looking at the sensor level. The sensor is the basic of the data. Anything else is just a continuation of the operation north. So this is my email address. If anybody wants to connect, communicate with us, we'll be happy to talk. Thank you everybody for sharing the time today. Back to you, Alon.
Thank you very much, Sion. So just as a reminder, we had four speakers from four different companies. We had Yaron from ThetaRay. We had Phil from CyberX. We had Eran from Nanolock and now Sion from IXDen. Please continue sending us questions. We're going to move to the Q&A shortly. And I would also like to invite all of you to our upcoming webinars. That the next one is next Wednesday, overviewing innovation. And we will have we will go in depth to the different topics we discussed at the beginning of this webinar. I think it's going to be fantastic. And we're working on a major virtual event, the OurCrowd Pandemic Innovation Conference online. That will be happening the end of June. We understand the need for innovation at these kind of times, and we need to prepare ourselves for the next pandemic. We hope it won't happen, but in case, we know that innovation will be our tool to overcome it. So I would like to ask Lali, David, to join me for the Q&A session. By the way, my contact info is here. If you'd like an introduction to any of the company, you feel free to contact us as well. You can use my contact details here. Lali is going to join us in a moment.
I'm joined, Alon. Thank you.
Lali just joined us for the Q&A. Continue asking questions as we start.
Thank you, Alon. Yeah. Let's go through some of the questions already.
Sure.
Some of the questions were very specific about technologies. And were answered by the CEOs, for example, the IXDen versus Nanolock. And other questions had to do with innovation. What I want to highlight, we had a few questions about how do we choose companies in cyber? How do you choose which one to invest in? And as written down in the answers, it's really not one winner takes it all. We think there are plenty of issues and plenty of technologies. And you need to diversify your investments as an investor. One question I want to open to the different representative from the portfolio companies, a question about remote asset management. How does cybersecurity, data security can address remote asset management. Maybe one of the portfolio companies would like to address this specific issue. And the other one that is open for you to address is home security assessment. How does organizations solve or address home security assessment and posture? Maybe Phil, actually, you want to begin?
Yes, hi. Thank you, Lali. Remote asset management, in the way our clients talk about it, is discovering the assets that you have connected to your network. Because as we saw, most organizations don't know which IoT devices they have connected to their network. But it's more than just identifying them by, let's say, their IP address. You also want to know what type of device is it. So that will make it easier to develop segmentation policies. You can say all types of devices like this should be on this segment of our network. It helps you also identify what patches are missing from those devices. And then you can look at how they're connected to each other and how they're behaving to make sure that you've closed the path that a cyber criminal would use or cyber attacker would use to get to your most important assets, which we call the crown jewel assets.
Thank you. Maybe more to for Yaron, in terms of VPNs, how safe they are, how is it changing these days, the VPN networks? Maybe you can address this point.
Yes, of course. When we use VPN, we are in a safer environment where compared to not using VPN, that's for sure. But even when we use VPN, the fact that now we are connecting from home devices more than in normal behavior or normal routine expose us to be under an attack that we are not even aware of, that maybe the device itself experienced a takeover by a malware or by an attacker. And then when we connect from this device itself to through the VPN, we might not even know, and everything we do is overseen by a non-necessary partner that is also seeing our device, our screen, at the time that we use it.
Sorry, maybe a question to Iran. Maybe Iran, you can also address remote assets, as it's very relevant to you as well.
Thanks. I think COVID created a very interesting challenge where many of the assets were inaccessible because people were quarantined. So you have billions of devices out there inaccessible by the guys who should take care of them. So that created a need, it's a consequence, as a need to both remote access and remote management, remote fixing, remote updates, remote patching, and what is actually called as over-the-air updates, over-the-air maintenance. And that created a need for, I think many of the companies speaking here, to secure the channel, to secure the fact that instead of a person coming to the device, it's data being sent to the device and from the device. So IXDen, CyberX, and us, I think, and probably also ThetaRay, has to secure the fact that people are not coming to the device, see them in their own eyes, but have to do that remotely. One of the most beautiful attacks is where you have fake devices in the system. And when you cannot see the device, everything is potentially fake. So that created a tremendous problem. And I think all the four companies speaking here benefited from this challenge.
Thank you. Maybe just one last question to Tion from IXDen. How do you see COVID basically affect the different priorities of the different customers you're having conversations with? How does it accelerate different needs for cyber? Maybe you can address this one specifically. This will be our last question.
Yeah, I think from our experience, especially we are working now in the US with few customers, working in the oil and gas industry, couldn't send, a technician to the field, upstream, the upstream, it's usually not very close to urban city. It was a big, big problem for them to see what to do with this, actually to trust, not to trust. And especially with the crisis of the oil, it was a big, big mess for them. And they were anxious to see how can they solve it. The remote asset came up very, very quickly up to top management, top decision, to see how we can solve. And actually, that's what we're trying to say. And I think Iran mentioned that we are trying to bring them a new solution to work remotely. And this is, it's a big, big problem today. Hopefully we can help.
Yeah, I think we see that across the portfolio, across different sectors. We have companies now addressing sectors that they did not touch before. And now COVID accelerates different needs, and the companies are agile enough to address the needs and by applying their technologies to the different needs created by COVID across different sectors. This has been a pleasure. Thank you, everyone, for joining.